to you. What a great day it is to worship our Lord together. I pray that wherever you're at, you can turn us up loud, that you can join us, stand and worship with us as we praise the name of our God.
Holy thunder, who leaves us breathless.
Lord, you never leave us and you never forsake us. forsake us. Lord, I pray that we would just get such a special sense of your Holy Spirit wherever we are right now, Lord. Fill the room, Lord, with your Holy Spirit to come and minister to us today. Lord, only you know exactly what we need. Only you know the way that we need to be encouraged, or the word that we need to hear, or the miracle that we need. Lord, and we serve a God who is able. And so we just lift your name high today. And we say thank you. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you for bringing us here together today in one name to worship the one true God. And we are just so grateful that soon we will be in the church building together to sing your praises. What a beautiful day that will be. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, Calvary family. Thanks for joining us today. At the conclusion of worship here, we want to take some time to start the year with communion. Just seems such a perfect and appropriate way to really start the year. Honestly, we always do it on the first Sunday of the month, and here we are January 3rd. And so I just want to encourage you at home. I know you don't have the regular elements. You don't have our little prepackaged communion elements, but you do have something that you can take. And you know, as we've been talking during this season and the pandemic, we know that it's not the specific elements that we use. It's a matter of our heart and our attitude. And so as we look to the beginning of 2021, I just want to encourage you to find something. Take it with crackers and orange juice. But it's a matter of the intent and purpose in our heart as we take it. And so I love the fact that communion is the representation of our new covenant with Jesus, and that covenant being the promise. And the thing that I love so much about it as we look at the beginning of this year is that January is that time that so many people make a new commitment to start fresh and start over. And even though many aspects of 2020 carry over into 2021, we can still look at it with new hope and fresh eyes and look for those things that we desire to see different in our own life. And so this morning, why don't you go ahead and prepare your elements, get yourself ready, since it's just me here with you online. I'll go ahead and get both elements ready. And I want to go through what Paul shares with us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Here's what he says, and starting in verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Just take whatever element you're using for communion this morning and reflect on the fact that the sacrifice Jesus made so long ago is just as powerful and effective today. This body that we are called to remember is just as powerful this morning. It doesn't matter how long it's been since you've known Jesus. That's why this is so important in our Christian walk, is to reflect on the significance of his death. And so let's give thanks this morning for his body. Father, we thank you. Jesus, you were beaten, you were scourged, you were crucified on a cross. You sacrificed your body for us. The Word of God tells us that it's by your stripes we are healed. And it was at the crucifixion that you took those stripes for our healing. And so this morning, we give thanks. Just as the disciples did on that Passover Seder with you that we call the Last Supper, we give thanks for your goodness, for your sacrifice, for your mercy. We give thanks for the pain and the suffering that you went through for us. You took a beating that none of us would have been able to endure. But the significance of what you did should never be lost. And so this morning we say thank you. Thank you for your gift. Thank you for your body. In your name, Amen. You take the communion with me this morning, the bread? In the same way, it tells us that after the meal, Jesus took the cup. Now, I've said this before, and I really mean it. I love the fact that it was after the meal that Jesus took the cup, because at the end of the meal is when you start really digging into the relationships and the friendships and those significant connections that we have. And I think it's so important to keep in mind that communion was separated from the beginning to the end of the meal. And Jesus was reinforcing his love for his disciples. And in the same way, he does the same thing for us. It says, in the same way after supper, he took the cup. And so I encourage you, take whatever it is that you have this morning for the cup. He says, this cup is the new covenant. The new covenant. Covenant is it's a promise. The new promise. And as we look fresh at the new year, what a great way to refresh the covenant that we have with Jesus. This new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. What a great honor we have. What a great honor we have. Let's give him thanks. Jesus, this cup represents your commitment, your covenant with us. Let us never forget it. Let us never neglect it. Let us never walk away from it. We give you thanks. We give you thanks this morning because you died for us, shed your blood on a cross because of your great love for us. And I pray this morning, as we look afresh and anew to 2021, that covenant would be just as powerful and real to us as the first day we accepted you. Bless this cup today. In your name, amen. Amen. You take the cup with me. Hallelujah. Jesus, we thank you so much. We pray blessings this morning. We thank you and we praise you. In your precious name, amen. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us online. I'm so glad you could be with us today. We'll be back in person next week. So I appreciate your flexibility and adjustments. I appreciate the staff taking care of things. Last week, we had some curveballs thrown to us, and I was down with COVID, and I'm doing much better, feeling good. Still a little tired, and just a little tiredness is really all I'm dealing with right now, but I appreciate so much the team coming together and making it possible. But again, we'll be back together in person next week. You know, 2021 has started, and we always kick it off with a bang. January 1st, my birthday. I know since we're not meeting in person, I'm sure you probably had a party planned. Don't worry about it. It'll be okay. But it's always a good celebration. And, you know, the new year is always a time when people start looking towards a fresh start. And this is no different, really. You can still do that, even though we're still in the midst of dealing with the pandemic and COVID and all that. We can still look at things that we desire to see change and grow. And really, one of the areas that I think God has blessed Calvary Lighthouse with so much is in generosity. And you hear me talk about it each and every week about how generous you are as a church. And even though last week we didn't meet, you guys did immensely enormous great things in your giving. And I want to say thank you for that. But there's always opportunity to grow. And so here's one of the things that I had a pastor used to say this all the time, and I think it's a great prayer, especially as this draws on. Sometimes we realize that financial circumstances and situations change, but here's what we pray for you. Because I really believe at the core of most people, they desire to be generous. But oftentimes they don't know how to be generous because of either past financial decisions, current financial circumstances, or they've never seen it modeled, or there's lots of reasons I think why people aren't generous. I'm not sure how much of it is from like a lack of desire. I'm sure there's some, but I think the majority of people want to be generous, just as Jesus and God have been generous with us. And so here's my prayer for you. If you are currently without a job, I pray that God would bring along the right job for you, to open up doors of opportunity for you so that you could grow in your generosity. If you need a better job, I pray that God would open up that door for you. And if you're already thriving in the place where God has for you, then I would pray that He would show you extraordinary generosity and show how you go above and beyond. You know, we talk about tithe and tithing, that 10% offering really is just the beginning of generosity. But I know that God blesses the heart of people that give with a cheerful heart. The attitude of generosity, as Calvary has shown time and time again. And so as we kick off the new year, this is a great opportunity to start the habit of giving if you haven't already, or to grow in the habit of giving so that we can move from, you know, there's those that they kind of give a little bit, but maybe not a full tithe. And then those that are given a tithe, but maybe not an offering. There's always opportunity to grow in generosity. And I pray that God would move on your heart and would give you that generous spirit that has been demonstrated time and time again within our church. Just a reminder, since we are online only, you can give today via the website, which is at calvarylighthouse.org/give. That's really the easiest way to give. If you want to mail in your tithes and offering, you can mail it to the church, 1133 East County Line Road. That's Lakewood 08701. It'll be on the screen so you can see it. We'll be back in person next week. We won't have any midweek service this week, and so there won't be any opportunity. The office will be open if you want to stop by and drop it off, but there also you can always mail it or do it online and trust God. Let's pray for this morning's tithe and offering and trust God for our continued generosity in the hearts of His people. Father, I thank You so much. 2021 is, we're starting online, not in person, but we know that Your Spirit's with us wherever we're at. And I pray today that You would continue to pour out Your provision and Your blessings on Your people. Let them see Your generosity and respond in kind. I pray for those that need jobs, that You would help them to find the right opportunity. I pray for those that need to find better jobs, that You would open the doors of opportunity. And I pray that we would all grow in the grace of giving today. Be with us this morning. In Your precious name, amen. Amen. God bless you as you give this morning.
Now, my name is Brian Fallon, and my experience with fasting was one of the things I had struggled with a couple years ago was that I could not seem to shake smoking cigarettes. And no matter how hard I would try, I would pray all the time about it. And I wanted to do it. It was something that I would do often, like attempt to quit, and then it should go back and come. And it seems like maybe a silly thing, especially for a Christian to struggle with. That's how it seemed to me. I felt silly. Like I shouldn't have been doing that. I should have known better. I should have been, but you know, lots of things. But one thing that I did find is that, you know, when I would do the annual fast, I took it very seriously and did it, when I quit and I did not fast to quit anything or get away from it, or like, you know, God, if I fast, You'll free me from this. That wasn't, I felt that you know, when I was praying that the answer was that if I got more Jesus, I would, then the other things would be gone, or would go away, more of them. And I didn't know which one of the more, but I knew that by fasting, I would get more Jesus and inherently less self. And all that comes with it. So when I did, it didn't miraculously leave. I still went through a program with the American Lung Association and did the gum and the patch thing. But before that, I had tried that all before. But before I really set aside some time to fast and get closer to God, that's the keys, the getting closer. And the thing that I felt like I got more Jesus and less me. And then I had the strength to do it, and it went away, and I haven't had one since. And that was just my struggle. So that's my story.
Well, good morning, Calvary family. Thanks for being here. Today, I just wanted to take a little bit of time, and we'll see how long we're here together. I wanted to take a few minutes and go through five predictions for 2021. I'm sure we all wish we had a little crystal ball or clairvoyant knowledge of what it was going to be, but I've got five predictions I can guarantee are going to come true and know that it's going to happen this year. Which is going to be encouraging to all of us, because the reality is today is filled with all sorts of uncertainty, isn't it? And I don't like it. I'm sure you don't either. We got uncertainty about the future, uncertainty about the economy, uncertainty about the COVID lockdowns, uncertainty about the government. There's just all sorts of uncertainty. And the uncertainty in the situation, it hits the world's population in such a way that it just increases everybody's stress level. How many of you have felt more stressed in 2020 than you recall being stressed before? I know I have. The one of the side effects of uncertainty is this loss of hope. We feel like there's just not a lot of hopefulness in the next year. God, the Word of God tells us actually that hope is the anchor of the soul. And when the anchor of one's life has been disabled, that wind of uncertainty it will certainly have devastating effects on our lives. Diana Barnes said, certainty is a stop the mind makes between uncertainty. And so if we don't have certainty, what do? We just keep bouncing back and forth, and it really exhausts us. And so I want to talk to you today about the predictions I have for 2021. Now, here's the first prediction I have that I know it's going to come true. The Word of God will continue to be our foundation and strength in 2021. Here's what 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22 to 25 says. It says, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of a corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is like grass, and all of the glory of man are as flowers of the grass. The grass withers, and its flowers fall away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And then Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8 tells us this, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we know that from what it says in John, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. We know that that is a reference to Jesus. So we know that the Word of God is going to last forever and will be our strength, our encouragement, and will help us in this next season. Hebrews 4:12 says this, for the Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of the soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So no matter what else changes in this world, the Word of God remains strong and faithful and true in this life. Abraham Lincoln, here's what he said. He said, I believe the Bible is the best gift God has ever given to man. All the good of the Savior of the world is communicated to us through this book. I predict that in 2021, the Bible is going to remain true. Here's the second thing I'm going to predict for 2021 that I think we can find encouragement in. I predict that God will continue to love everyone and will continue to love sinners. We know that God doesn't love sin, right? God despises sin. But the church has a mandate to continue to share God's love with those that do not yet know Jesus. That's why we hold so true to John 3:16. We know what it says. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." The purpose of this verse and the heart of God is revealed in the life of Christ. And so we know that God is going to continue to love sinners. God is going to continue to love those that have not yet come to the saving knowledge of him. And God does it through his church. This is the joyous thing that we know, is that with all of the uncertainty and difficulty and challenges that we have faced in this year, we can still rely on the fact that God loves the people of this world. God loves sinners. He's willing that none, he's not willing that none should perish, but that all the world would come to repentance. St. Augustine said this: God loves each of us as if there were only one of us. That doesn't make you and me unique when we know Jesus. It means that we have accepted that, but there are those that do not yet know the truth, and they need to hear it. We as a church have that mission. Just think of some of the biblical examples of what God has done in the lives of people. Abraham was a liar. Moses was a murderer. Jacob was a deceiver. Samson was a womanizer. David was a murderer and a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. There are so many different examples. Paul, he persecuted the church. But all of them experienced the love of God because that's who he is. So the question we ask is, who deserves the love of God? The answer is no one. Who's qualified to receive the love of God? Everyone. That's the fact that we live in. And that fact isn't going to change regardless of what happens in 2021. So here's a life-changing truth that I want you to hold on to from C.S. Lewis. It says, "We have never looked or locked eyes with anyone that God doesn't love." God loves us so much that he can't let us stay like we are. Here's the third thing that I can predict for 2021 that I know will be true. And I don't know what this year's looked like for you, but this year I have prayed more than I ever have before. And here's what we can hold on to for 2021. Prayer will continue to be the most effective thing that we as Christians can do. You know, prayer is one of the things we talk about a lot, but we don't necessarily always teach on. Now, we as a church have talked about and highlighted and emphasized the need for prayer, and I hope that you are holding on to that. We want to pray for you. We want to trust God for you, and we want you to know that prayer in your own life and in the life of those around you is one of the most important things that you can do. A.J. Gordon, he said this. He goes, "We can do more than prayer after we have prayed, but we can never do more than pray until we have prayed." Prayer is not just a spiritual ritual. Prayer is not just a spiritual behavior. Prayer is an act that transforms lives. It changes circumstances and situations. It moves the hand of God. And I want to encourage you in this season, pray like you have never prayed before. E.M. Bounds said this: "God shapes the world by prayer. The more prayer there is in the world, the better the world will be." Pray for those who persecute you. Pray for those who hate you. Pray for those that do not know the saving grace of God. Pray like you've never prayed before. That's still one of the most effective things. I predict that Christians will continue to be a force to be reckoned with in 2021 if they learn how to pray effectively. Hey, and just as a reminder, you saw the testimony that we shared today. Their annual church fast is coming up. Going to start January 17th. It'll be 2 weeks of prayer and fasting, and then we will have a worship night January 31st. And so we're excited about that. January 17th to the 31st will be our 2 weeks of prayer and fasting, because prayer and fasting changes lives, changes circumstances and situations. Here's the fourth prediction that I've got for 2021. The Holy Spirit will continue to build the church of Jesus Christ. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 17 and 19, here's what it says, reading from the New King James Version. It says, Jesus answered and said to him, Blessed are you, Simon, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. It's Jesus talking. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. In this portion of scripture, Jesus is making a very bold and forward-thinking prediction concerning the church. He was telling you that the church will be born and built and sustained by him. We, as the church, have to respond to what God is going to do. And if we want to be the New Testament church that Jesus desires for us to be, we just have to be willing to follow his lead. Jesus lets us know that he's predicting it's not something that may or may not come to pass. When Jesus says it, it's true. It's going to be fulfilled. If you look at that, the verb in the portion of scripture where Jesus says that he will build the church, it's actually in the future tense. And so he's saying that the building of the church will without question come to pass. And the reason that the construction and life of the church is so secure, and this is why we as Christians can be secure and comforted in difficult times, the reason that it is so secure is because it's locked into the promises of Jesus. When Jesus promises something, God is 100% faithful. Jesus is not a liar. And so we know when he says he will build the church, that it's going to happen. He's the architect, the builder, and the designer. He will build his church. And in building his church, God uses people like you and me. Broken, failed, imperfect people. He doesn't reject anyone. You know, not long after Jesus makes that assertive promise, I will build my church, the Holy Spirit is poured out on the first century church. And we've been talking about the book of Acts, but there are dozens of places in the book of Acts where the Holy Spirit is building the church. Think about it. On the first day on Pentecost, when Peter preaches in Acts chapter 2, how many were added to the church that day? 3,000. And then at the end of that chapter, what's it say? It says God added to their numbers daily. And then as we walk through, which we're going to start back up in the book of Acts next week, as we walk through all of the just different verses in Acts, we see time and time again where God has built his church. Jesus said, I will build my church. He has, he is, and he will continue. He will continue to do it. We've been invited to be a part of that building process. That's why our tithes and offering, that's why our serving and volunteering, that's why our commitment to Christ is so important. Because we've been invited to build the greatest body and family that has ever been known in this world, the body of Jesus Christ. And I predict that in 2021, Jesus will continue to build his church. Yeah, he's going to. That's Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. This isn't in my notes. Has been one of those verses that has helped sustain me through 2020, because that's been a hard, it's been a hard year. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, it says, let us not grow weary in doing well for one another, for we will reap a harvest if we do not quit. I believe the harvest is coming. I don't know what it looks like. I don't know what 2021 looks like. I've got a few predictions, right? And I've got one left for you. But here's what I know. We will reap a harvest if we do not give up. God has been faithful. God has been so faithful. Let's continue to trust in him. And actually, that's my fifth prediction for 2021. God will continue to be faithful. I don't know how you've experienced God's faithfulness this year. I can tell you how I've experienced it. I got COVID, but God carried me through it. It's been a hard year. We haven't had a chance to see our family in much capacity. My family's all in Ohio and Missouri and stuff. And so that's been hard, hasn't it? Maybe you've experienced it. But Heather and I and Bennett are doing great. Even though it's been hard, God has shown his faithfulness. I can tell you as a church, even though we haven't filled the sanctuary back up, well, first of all, we're not allowed to. But listen, people continue to stay online, connected with us. Our giving has increased in 2020 over 2019. That only happens because of the faithfulness of God. You know, the faithfulness of God, it's something that's clearly seen throughout the Word of God. It's amazing how God provided for his people in times where it appeared to be impossible. Think of the children of Israel. Even though they had, in many ways, disappointed God, they had to wander for 40 years in the desert, but he still provided for them. He still provided for their daily needs for 40 years. That should be encouraging to us. And I pray that we're not in this for 40 years. I don't want to do that. But I know that if and when, that's one of those old church things. Should the Lord tarry, right? Should the Lord tarry, we know that he's going to be faithful. We know he's going to be faithful. And so here's what someone said one time, said, God never comes too late or with too little. He is always right on time with more than enough. Charles Spurgeon, he once said, we believe in the providence of God, but we do not believe half enough in it. Listen, I'm sure you've experienced God's faithfulness in your life. And God will continue to be faithful in 2021. God's faithfulness doesn't mean everything works out the way we think it's going to work out. God's faithfulness means that we trust and rely on him, and he sustains us through difficult times. And I pray that you can see his hand at work in your life. It might not be exactly where you think you want to be or you should be, but I promise you this, God will be faithful in 2021. You know, as we look at it, a lot of people, they interpret faithfulness as everything's going exactly the way we want. But that's not really what it looks like. They get off base. They think that God forgot them. But I imagine the people of Israel, when they wandered in the desert for 40 years, had moments like that themselves. What's God doing? What's God teaching us? But when we look at it with the eyes that say, I know God's got me covered. I know God's got me protected. Then we start looking at it with the view that says, I know, even in the midst of difficulty, God's with me. You know, in the midst of uncertain times, let's just remember what the Word of God says. The presence of God supports us. It says we're underneath his everlasting arms. The presence of God overshadows us. It says the shadow of his hand. The presence of the Lord is beside us like a shade on our right and left hand. The presence of God goes before us. It says the steps of good people are ordered by God. The presence of God is all around us. It says like a hen protects her children. He's got the whole world in his hand. You remember that song? He's got the whole world in his hand. You know, the children of God have nothing to fear. Even though there's plenty of uncertainty in this world, even though there's plenty of difficulty in this world, I predict that in 2021, God will remain faithful. God will remain faithful. He didn't leave us without comfort. He provided everything we need to make it through whatever we are called to endure. Let's not give up. Let's not quit. Let's look to the harvest that God has promised is coming. There's no need to allow our circumstances or our situations to discourage us. God has placed us where we are, but he's also assured us that he will come again. And I predict that if we learn how to press into the presence of God, that the Lord will continue to lead us, guide us, direct us, sustain us, and encourage us in 2021. Those are my predictions for 2021. Trust in God, rely on him, and allow him to guide you and direct you. It's hard, I know. But God is faithful. I look forward to seeing you in person next week. We want to see you with us. Don't forget, annual church fast starts January 17th. We'll have a couple more reminders in there. But let's just reflect. This is what I want you to do this week. I want you to reflect on the faithfulness of God. Start a journal. Write it down. So that way, in those moments when you feel overwhelmed, you can reflect on all that God has done for you in 2021, or for you in 2020, that he will do for you in 2021. Because God is faithful. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much. As we start this year, I pray that you would be with us, help us, encourage us, those that are overwhelmed, brokenhearted, feeling the pinch of where we're at. I pray that we would lean into your promises and see all that you've done for us. Be with us today. In your precious name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for being with us today. We'll see you next Sunday.